Ladies and gentlemen, it is Friday, April 26th, 2013. And I am your host, Alex Jones. And this is what it sounds like when I actually have a radio microphone in front of me. Most talk show hosts get a big, fancy microphone, and they get right up on it, and then they tweak it and tune it and put all this different effects on it to make their voice sound big. I do the opposite. Why, I don't know. But there are no effects on this microphone. This is just my voice. And yes, I'm bragging right now about my voice. And I'm sorry, ladies, but I'm taken, okay? I'm just acting stupid, folks. I'm joking. I'm sorry. That's what it sounds like. Because I come on, and then my voice sounds so big that I feel guilty like I'm an egomaniac. I'm actually a liberty maniac, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm not operating on a lot of sleep last night. I was up late here at the hotel with George W. Bush, Dick Cheney, the heads of Hunt Oil, and Joseph Curl of the Washington Times and DrudgeReport.com. And I'm not kidding. That's who I was hanging out with last night in a very, very bizarre turn of events. So here we are. I am at a hotel in Dallas, Texas, and George W. Bush is sitting on my lap. No, that part's a joke. My mother always liked this hotel. I'm not going to say what hotel because obviously we're incognito. But I'm up here in Dallas driving through visiting family because I'm from Dallas. And then I'm going to go with my children and family and parents, you know, to another location in Texas. Why lie? Arkansas. So I'm taking a few days, just an extension of Texas, or are we an extension of Arkansas? And so I come in the hotel, and there's ambulances parked out front, and there's Secret Service running around, and I guess they've got like four presidents right now. What is it? Clinton, Obama, you've got Bush Sr., Bush Jr., so that's four. Were there others? And so they're here for the opening of the presidential library. And then this is where some of them are staying. I know Bush lives in Dallas, but I'll tell the story later, obviously, ladies and gentlemen, of Curl and I trying to crash the private Bush-Cheney party. And I'm not joking. I actually didn't hang out with them last night, but the cops then said, the cops recognized me definitely, and were like, okay, no, you're not on the list. And then, the police officer went on to say, what's the big joke here? And I said, it's not a joke. I mean, you know, we see the Secret Service and Dick Cheney's ambulance that follows him around. And so we want to, you know are they really here? And then later I noticed that they, actually, Richard, it's laying over there by that lamp, bud. And then go get yourself some lunch. Good job hooking up all this equipment. Richard Reeves on the road with us here, because even when I go on vacation for 2 or 3 days, I work. Over there is that list that I found in the bar. Bring that to me. I don't want to show the whole list because it'll say where we're at. Thank you. Here in my little hand is the list of who was at the private party last night. Karl Rove, along with Mr. Ray Hunt of Hunt Oil, will be throwing an event after the rest of the Bush Library dedication events. This has been described as our personal event and reunion for most of the people attending. Attendees are friends of former staff associated with George W. Bush administration. And again, Curl was here to cover it. He has an article up at DrudgeReport.com about Bush, the Washington Times writer. He was here to cover it, and we ran into each other in the bar. I said, no, Bush and Cheney and all them are upstairs. He goes, well, the big party, I was invited to that. He said, but, you know, that's at this other hotel. And I said, look, they're up there. And sure enough, they were. Just crazy. Authoritarian control freaks throughout history have sought to make populations dependent. The United Nations openly has talked about using food as a weapon against the Third World and the industrialized First World. State Department Memorandum 200, developed by Henry Kissinger, called for destroying the food capacity, not just of the United States, but every country in the world, so they could use food scarcity as a political weapon of control. Just a decade ago, less than 10 million Americans were on food stamps. 4 years ago, it was 25 million. It's now reached almost 50 million. Socialist healthcare is designed to destroy our healthcare system. The establishment wants you to be a bunch of cowardly, dumbed-down people who can't stand up for yourselves. That's why they're rushing to try to restrict citizens owning firearms. Because since the early 1990s, gun ownership has gone straight up, while violent crime has gone straight down by 49%. And globalist-controlled strongholds like Chicago and New York, where they've taken the citizens' guns, have the highest crime rates in the world. What am I getting at here? The system doesn't want you to be self-sufficient. That's why I promote the fact that you should go out, buy firearms, and go take lessons and learn how to use them. I want you to stand up for your birthright of liberty and freedom. During a serious meltdown, they're going to tell you, hey, you want food? Turn in your guns. And that's why we need to put the globalists in check. And then finally bring them to checkmate by being self-sufficient, by being prepared, by having a garden, by learning how to can your own foods, by having friends and family and community that will stand together. But at the heart of that is having quality, storable foods. And that's why I went out more than a decade ago and found the very best food company to be my sponsor, eFoods Direct. They're the company that I personally use for my emergency food storage preparation, whether it be for natural disasters or the tyranny that is intensifying. So give them a call, 800-409-5633. That's 800-409-5633 or eFoodsDirect.com/Alex to find the weekly and monthly specials. But they're always running the specials where you can get the free six meals and the eFoods Direct audio CD put together by the experts in storable foods to answer all your questions, the eFoods planning guide, the eFoods brochure, the eFoods catalog, plus six free meals, creamy potato soup, tortilla soup, and cheesy chicken rice, so you can sample the high-quality storable foods from eFoods Direct. They've got a bunch of other specials.
The two-week food supply provides one adult with 81 servings of healthy, delicious, storable food for 14 days.
The one-month food supply provides 192 servings for 28 days.
And then there's the one-month family food pack. It will change the way you look at the food in your pantry. Every time you eat one of these meals, you are eating healthy, delicious food and saving a lot of money.
The three-month food supply, 576 servings of storable food for 91 days.
And the one-year food supply will provide you with 2,304 servings of healthy, delicious, storable food for one full year.
Your meals are as delicious and nutritious tonight as they'll be in 25 years.
Bottom line, there's a bunch of specials at eFoodsDirect.com/Alex. You can also call them at the toll-free number on your screen, and they can send you a catalog with all the specials detailed and tell you about the weekly and monthly specials that they're always running. eFoodsDirect.com/Alex to find all the specials or call the toll-free number. And so in closing, when you buy from eFoodsDirect.com, you are supporting the radio broadcast, the nightly news, the magazine, the films, and everything we're doing. Because we're not like MSNBC or Media Matters that get government and corporate funding to bring down America and bring in tyranny. We are funded by our sponsors and you, the viewers and listeners, that support them. Again, that's eFoodsDirect.com/Alex or 800-409-5633. And when you're also visiting Infowars.com or PrisonPlanet.com, you can click on the banners to take you to the weekly and monthly specials. It's like the Hank Williams Jr. song, A Country Boy Can Survive, because you can't starve us out and you can't make us run because these boys were raised on shotguns. Well, there aren't really a lot of good old boys left anymore, are there? And those that are out there are demonized and are enemy number one by Homeland Security. And good old boys come in all shapes, colors, and sizes. They're people that aren't chumps, who understand that they're going to take care of their family and that nobody else is. There are people that understand that if somebody else is taking care of them, that makes them a slave. And that the government doesn't want you dependent because they want to build a great future for you. They want to get you dependent so they can social engineer us. So the answer is get self-sufficient, become men again, and tell the New World Order to go straight to hell. Alex Jones signing off for Infowars.com and eFoods Direct, our great sponsor. I come to you from my hometown of Dallas, Texas, here at the same hotel where Dick Cheney and other people are staying. I happened to run into them last night. I'll tell you that story coming up later. Ran into one of the reporters for the Drudge Report as well. We tried to crash the party, and I'm not kidding. I'm actually going to tell you that story coming up. Wow, here it is. You know, they said this a week ago, but now they're in the U.S. Parents deny son's guilt and accuse U.S. of plot. No, actually, they're still in Russia saying that yesterday. Now they're coming. This is in the New York Times. They go on to say the intelligence services had been on them for 5 years and had set them up and recruited them somehow. And that is exactly what they do in false flags. So there is the New York Times with that piece of news. We're going to be getting into that more today. Congressman Ron Paul is scheduled to join us at the start of the next hour. And then we are also going to be getting Cybele Edmonds on the broadcast. She was an FBI translator and witnessed them in the 9/11 stand down and running Al-Qaeda. That's on record. She had to break a federal gag order to bring that information out to you. And people say, well, if stuff like this happened, you know, if the government was involved in terror attacks, we would know, someone would talk. A lot of people did talk. And then they spin it and say, Chris Matthews says, Alex Jones says George W. Bush had like Wile E. Coyote, this is his exact words, with a plunger detonating it. I'm not saying that George W. Bush even probably knew what was going on, because I later talked to somebody who was with him in the bunker with another one of the Bushes that night after it happened, when he was, you know, basically scurrying around scared. I mean, not so much scared, but I mean, he was either that or he's a great actor, which I don't think George W. Bush is. But the people behind him, the globalists that control presidents, control societies, they created Al-Qaeda, they run Al-Qaeda, and they are using the threat of Al-Qaeda to basically take over our society and make everyone a suspect. There's an article up at Infowars.com where a new FBI manual flyer says anyone taking pictures, period, or video anywhere is a suspected terrorist. Put them in a terrorist database. And that's why the cops come up to you and arrest you now if you're, you know, videotaping the Eiffel Tower in Paris or if you're videotaping the Washington Monument. I've actually had the police come over. We have this on tape. Put it on the web, you've seen it, and say, what are you doing? And we're like, well, we're getting video of the Washington Monument. Why? Well, I don't have to answer your questions in America, but it's for my TV show. Do you have a permit for that? And I was actually sitting there with a C-Think film crew for the Independent Film Channel, and they looked at the cop and they go, DC doesn't give permits because you don't need a permit to be in a public place or on the street with a camera. You need a permit if you're going to block a street. And the cop said, hey, I'm going to arrest you if you don't leave. And so in America, we left. Just because we were there to get a job done and weren't there to fight for the First Amendment that day, but maybe we should have gotten arrested. Maybe we need to stop giving in every time we get pushed around. My point is, it's about making us the suspects. But the novel idea of, could it be the government, or could it be elements in the government, or could it be defense contractors that want to sell trillions of dollars of more stuff and who want to make America the war zone and get paid $10 billion per company per year to spy on our email and spy on what we're saying. This is all admitted now. Everything we talked about for so long is now admitted. And so now I'm telling you what's coming next. Now, again, riding shotgun with us today are Jakari Jackson and the other InfoWars Nightly News reporter, one of the other reporters, David Knight. And again, our Skype is a little bit catchy today, so I want to ask the network, every time my Skype cuts out and you go to backup Skype, will you give me a Roger Houston that I'm on the air? Okay, Roger, that's great. Because when I see my screen go black and you guys are reconnecting, what, did you go to backup Skype there? Well done, Houston. They're actually in Austin, but Houston is close enough. And again, I'm here in Dallas orbiting around Dick Cheney right now, who is somewhere in the building. I can't make up the weirdness of all this. Is it synchronicity or serendipity that I ran into Dick Cheney and George Bush here in Dallas Or, no, it'd be like, I ran into the Super Bowl. What do you know? I came to this town. The Super Bowl is happening here this weekend. No, the presidential library is being opened, and so that's why this happened. And I didn't even think of this. By the way, I was on my way yesterday, driving up here, and right off I-35 is the town of West, where that fertilizer plant blew up. So we thought, hey, let's pull over at the Czech shop, a place that has hot sandwiches. That's a Texas tradition, and about three blocks away is where the fertilizer plant blew up. So I said, let's drive by it. Well, we go driving by it on a city street, and the state police were even stopping firemen and stuff that were there for the funeral that had just ended, and there were helicopters flying above, because I was told Obama had been there, but he was gone. And the state police came over with such pleasure and said, what do you think you're doing here? And we said, well, we're just driving by to see what's going on. And he goes, we can't go that way. And I go, okay, well, where do we turn around? He goes, well, you can't turn around. He starts smiling at us. So I jump up, because Richard was driving, and peer out of the bus. And I said, oh, so I'm an American scum. You're enjoying me, watching me squirm. Well, I shot video of it. You basically have seen it. And people are like, Alex is a real wimp. He drove all the way up to West. And then when they told him to leave, he did. No. I am a wimp, but not in the way you think I am. I'm actually pretty tough. I'm being sarcastic, folks. Not a lot of sleep. I apologize. The point is that we were driving by and just thought we'd do a report for you. So it was kind of a drive-by, literal drive-by media. But it just illustrates that then his commander, his superior comes over and goes, yeah, you can turn around right there. And the other guy was starting to get mad, like he was going to do something to us. Because we're totally polite. We're like, no, we're just driving by. And he goes, well, why do you think you're going to do that? Well, we're just, okay, we're just going to turn up there. No, you can't do that. Okay, where can we turn around? Well, you can't turn around. And then smiling at us. I mean, this is the essence of government. It's like a kid using a magnifying glass to burn ants or something, or pull the wings off a butterfly. As Bradley Manning said about what the U.S. military does overseas. I mean, someday it'll be like total Skynet robots bombing and destroying and killing everybody in third world countries. I guess it's already happening. And then occasionally there'll be a bomb go off and they'll hype it up like the nation just defeated some incredible threat. So we have the perception that there was some type of, external thing going on and that we're not really the big empire taking over the world. And my biggest issue with the empire is not only is it immoral, but this giant mega empire that we're seeing unfold here, this giant mega empire, we're paying for it, and it's treating us just like it treats the other people that it's enslaving and destroying. This is not even an American empire. This is not an empire spreading liberty and freedom and the Bill of Rights and the Constitution like the CIA says. We overthrow countries to spread democracy. No, you put dictators and Al-Qaeda in, and now you run Al-Qaeda publicly in Libya and Syria and all over the place, and then lecture me how I'm un-American to point out the global crime syndicate, illegal mafia, is sitting here now declaring that I'm the enemy as well. I mean, it's asinine. Meanwhile, Big Sis says Homeland is using 1,000 more rounds per person than the Army. But she denies the ammunition purchases are aimed at civilians. Even though this military government, and that's what it is training to fight the American people in all their manuals and all their drills. You have enough ammo now to fight a 35-year war. It was a 27-year war in Iraq. It's now a 35-year war. They've gotten over a billion delivered. There's over a billion more that are on back order that they're going to get over the next few years. And then they have these headlines everywhere. Alex Jones discredited. Alex Jones gets his day in Congress. Congress takes up the conspiracy theory. Drudge Report takes up the conspiracy theory, the debunk theory about bullets. And then you read about the bullets, and they say, yes, we've bought 2+ billion bullets, and it's discredited that you said we did. I mean, I'm actually reading mainstream news going, the discredited bullet story, they're now having congressional hearings, let's cut to that clip. And then she says, well, we've bought them to save money, but it's not aimed at the American people. And, you know, the hollow points are illegal under the Geneva Convention. They are for target practice. When anyone knows you don't use hollow points that sometimes cost 3 to 4 to 5 times. They always cost more, usually about double for the cheaper brands, than the ball target ammo. Any shooter knows that. And it's all the training and the army manuals and the drills to acclimate us and what we just saw in Boston. And then she's saying, but it's not for you. It's not for you. And then you get the manuals. It's for conservatives, libertarians, returning veterans, gun owners, Ron Paul supporters, you name it. Now, again, riding shotgun today, and they'll be popping in with news reports and the latest breaking information, R. Jakari Jackson and David Knight. And we're going to be getting into all of this information today. Ron Paul is coming up and a lot more. We're going to break here in just about a minute and a half, but I want to throw it to the reporters there to take us out to break. Then I'll come back and get into the bullet story. Then we're going to get into, and I'm going to get their take on this, the latest on the Boston bombing, where I should be tooting our horn here. I should be recapping it, but you know, as listeners, you should be tooting your horn, not buying into it day one. But it's actually kind of sad and sick that we're right again. It's actually kind of sad and disgusting that it turned out to be a staged event. I mean, any way you cut it, any way you slice it, any way you dice it, these guys had CIA wiring up their snouts. I mean, they were absolute cutouts with the government obsessed with them for years. Ladies and gentlemen, we are broadcasting worldwide from high atop the Dick Cheney Command Complex in Dallas, Texas. I am actually broadcasting from high atop Dick Cheney's hotel with a train of ambulances behind him. You know, when he shot that guy in the face, out at that ranch in Texas, they reported they had 3 ambulances there. And when you go to a Bilderberg group meeting, sometimes they have like 7 or 8 ambulances for David Rockefeller and all the rest of them sitting out there. And I don't know why I'm going off into that. Sometime today, after Ron Paul comes on and we talk to Cybele Edmonds, people keep saying, why do you say Cybele? That's how you pronounce it. Not Cybele, she says Cybele. And I respect how she wants it pronunciated. So Cybele Edmonds is going to be joining us, incredible whistleblower coming up at the bottom of the next hour. And it's weird. You know, when I go on vacation, I just kind of get in a screwy mood. That's why I'm joking around a lot. But literally, I am in the same building as Dick Cheney right now. And it's just like just a little man creeping around on a cane. But just think of all the New World Order stuff he's been involved in. Just amazing how fragile life is, how short it is. People take themselves so incredibly seriously. And then you've got the video up on Infowars.com that John Bowne and Mark Dice and Rob Jacobson went and produced. And I want to be clear. They did that shoot in 15 minutes in Oceanside, California by L.A., and that is all the people they talked to. Okay, we did not go out there for 5 hours to find people that would sign a petition calling for America to be turned over to Nazi Germany and gun owners to be arrested and children to be injected with pure mercury. We went to English-speaking people and explained it to them, and they signed it. Because if you talk in a liberal voice, a snake voice, they're under a trance. We're going to go out with a snake voice in Austin, and we're going to call for babies to be killed in America up to age 3. We're going to call for a law, so it's legal, 4 babies, and Dice is doing another one. Well, he's already done it. He's going to have next week that's so controversial, he doesn't know if he should even air it. I mean, what he asked them, and they all agreed it was time to burn people, murder people, bury people. I just can't even believe it. I don't want to give away what he did. And again, we're going to be doing this as well to illustrate how the public is in a zombified state. And I got to say it, it's liberals that are like this. Even mainline Republicans that have got their problems and want to kill all the Muslims and have their issues, they have common sense and street smarts. I don't know, you know, I mean, compared to Democrats. Democrats are scary, and they always walk around talking about how smart they are all day. That's another thing they do. And they're not smart. They're dangerous, and they're crazy. And I said we'd go to our guest host here who were there riding shotgun with us today. They're going to be popping in with news alerts and little tidbits of information throughout the day. But you know me, in the first 30 minutes or so, I just get warmed up babbling Texas style, hillbilly style. David Knight, Jakari Jackson, what are you going to be interspersing today? Because you're going to be hosting the third hour all by your lonesomes today.
Oh, all by our lonesomes. Okay. Well, I'm Jakari Jackson here with David Knight. Just like Alex said, we have a few articles that we'll be conducting a little bit later. FBI conducts gun sweeps in Oakland. DHS and FBI warn of terrorist with cameras following Boston bombing. Now, this is exactly what we said would happen. And you have the Mad Owls and other people of the world saying, this is, they said this was going to be used to take your rights or something. And that's exactly what it is.
And I'm sick of that dude saying that we're wrong. And that I'm sick of him. He, as a man, he needs to gut up and admit we've been telling the truth.
Yeah, David, what do you have?
Well, there's news that the U.S. Mint is suspending sales of small gold coins. At the same time, premiums are rising. So it's going to be interesting. We're going to have Ron Paul on later. So it'll be interesting to see. I know he follows gold pretty closely, what he makes out of all the shortages of gold and silver. And, of course, we know what's happening with ammo. And there's an article about that on InfoWars today.
And the thing about that, I think Bloomberg was on, Ron Paul was on Bloomberg a couple of days ago. And they kept asking Ron Paul, why do you like gold? And he'd tell him why he likes gold. And why do you like gold? And then they switched anchors and just kept asking him the same question over and over, and I think we actually have.
Yeah, I don't get why they do that. I was on Obie and Anthony's show, and I think they do it and like 8 times. Norton kept asking me the same question, and I don't even know what that tactic is.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I guess they were trying to see if he would change his answer, and he always had, he always had a well-thought-out, thought-provoking answer, but they just weren't satisfied with his answer.
You know, Alex, you were talking about how dumbed down everything is in the wake of this bombing, the analysis of it. And there was an article that was on Lou Rockwell's page from Butler Schaefer, and he said, perhaps we ought to change the motto of the U.S. from "In God We Trust" to "Ignorance is Bliss." He said the failure in intelligence wasn't the fact that the FBI and the CIA and Homeland Security and all these other agencies had indicators that something was up with one of these brothers. Failure in intelligence is the American people abdicating their ability to look at information.
I disagree with that. I think we should worship the image of not a golden calf, but of an ostrich with its head in the sand. Folks, I'm coming to you from Dallas, Texas. Let me seriously get into some of the news here, and then we're going to have Jakari Jackson and David Knight there in Austin, Texas, break down some other important breaking news they have, like Planned Parenthood running around saying, hey, women, wear shirts saying I had an abortion. Absolutely. I sacrificed my child. I killed my child. I'm proud of it. Because, you see, they're losing the battle. Statistics and studies are showing people are turning against abortion. I'm not judging women that have had them. I'm not saying that you're a murderer. I'm saying you were manipulated into this, and now they're trying to make it something that's like laudable, like getting a gold medal or something. And in every culture, people have been lauded for killing their children. That's just something that's happened over and over and over again throughout civilization and in different cultures. So what I want to do actually right now is throw it over to Jakari Jackson and David Knight. What I want to cover first is, gentlemen, the latest developments that we were first talking about back last Monday during the tragic first hours of the bombing. We said if there's a drill, if the patsies were in intelligence services or protected by them, if they use it for some big power grab like martial law to basically condition us, if that happens, if we see all of these different telltale signs, then we know it's an inside job or at least a provocateur event, which is a type of inside job. And indeed, ladies and gentlemen, that is what has now happened. And if you look at the New York Times, parents deny son's guilt and accuse U.S. of plot. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's just the simple facts. That one brother was killed, the other climbed out of a boat and was just fine, and then suddenly had his throat cut out. And now what the senator first said back on Tuesday is now mainstream news that all these agencies, CIA, FBI, you name it, all knew exactly who these guys were and were, quote, following them, tracking them. The Russians blew their cover and said, who are these guys? And then it came out 2 days ago and has been in no mainstream media except foreign Russian news. They released the documents out of Georgia that indeed Tamerlan, Zardav, the older brother, indeed was in CIA-sponsored Jamestown Association groups under Zbigniew Brzezinski, whose plan it is to radicalize Muslims and use them worldwide as the tool to take liberties here in America, in the Middle East, and against Russia. And again, people say, what are you saying? There aren't radical Muslims? My whole world's about hating Muslims, and you know my dog's got an Al-Qaeda chew toy. No. I'm not saying there aren't radical Muslims and there isn't a clash of civilizations. What I'm saying is the globalists are throwing fuel on the fire as a way to take our liberties and have an excuse for all these wars and empires. And they use them like a Swiss Army knife or a skeleton key for every job. Going back like, this goes back to the British using radical Muslims out of Saudi Arabia to overthrow the different countries that were there before, turned it into one big country, and now they've used those guys worldwide. Hitler took over the Middle East for oil during the start of World War II when Rommel went in, and for the few years he had it before he got kicked out, what did they do? They set up and expanded the Muslim Brotherhood. Now, at the end of World War II, the keys got handed from Hitler over to the United States, and then Israel was set up basically as a command base over there, whether you support Israel or don't, or whether you just want peace over there. The point is, it was set up as like an aircraft carrier, you know, out there in the Middle East to basically be a base of military operations. And again, this wasn't done to democratize or bring freedom over there. It was done to put radical Muslims in charge. Look what we did, kicking out Mubarak, who wasn't a great guy, a Western-backed dictator, but he was a dictator, you know, back when the U.S. wasn't as openly evil. You know, I mean, we had corrupt people in there, but they weren't just absolutely pure evil. Now he's gone after 31 years, and they're putting basically Al-Qaeda light in. So that's my take on that. But this is a case of, this has absolutely come out in the open, and I want you guys to spend about 5 minutes breaking that down, and I want the guys to bring me down while you're doing that, because I want to readjust my camera. It actually fell off the computer here, so I have to
All right, we're here, I think. You know, picking up on what Alex was talking about, here's some of the agencies, according to the official story, that knew about this attack. You had the FBI, the CIA, U.S. Customs and Border Protection, mm-hmm. Boston Joint Terror Task Force, TIDE, that's a Terrorist Identities Data Mart Environment, and Homeland Security itself. All of these people had red flags raised to them about Tamerlan, the older brother. Mm-hmm. And yet, they didn't catch anything. Now,
and Napolitano said that she knew about it, but she didn't think it was a big deal.
Yeah, yeah. Janet, you failed us. All right, Homeland Security failed us. If you even look, if you don't look at anything else but the official story, you have to say that Homeland Security, which was created 12 years ago in the aftermath of 9/11, the whole rationale for the creation of Homeland Security was that we've got all these bureaucracies that aren't sharing information with each other, that aren't mm-hmm. communicating with each other, so we need one gigantic bureaucracy to rule them all. Okay, and that's what we've got with Homeland Security. And guess what? They're offering the same excuse they did 12 years ago. So right, why did we spend all this money on Homeland Security? Why did we centralize all this investigation? I mean, at that very level, their story has no credibility, and we should not be handing over any liberty to them at all. And we should take back the liberties that they took, because it wasn't a very good exchange for us.
And that's exactly the point, because not just terrorism databases, but all kinds of databases. You have the NSA data mining centers and all this stuff. And even with all the information they illegally collect on U.S. citizens, they still can't, you know, keep people from committing crimes. You know, right. I'm not necessarily referring to the Boston bombing suspects, but just in general, they can't keep people from committing the crimes with all the resources that they have.
Well, even if you look at the war on drugs, you have scores of people dying from drug overdoses mm-hmm. in federal prisons every year. Exactly. If they can't stop the flow of drugs in prisons to the extent that inmates can not only get drugs, but get enough of them to have an overdose, what kind of a society would we have to live in for them to be able to interdict drugs to protect us from ourselves? So the whole idea of using force and interdiction to stop everything is a failed idea. But it's just, when you look at even the no-fly list and the absurdity of that, mm-hmm. the fact that this TIDE thing flagged Tamerlan when he was heading back to Russia. And they decided to let him fly anyway. And yet you have children who are put on the no-fly list. Mm-hmm. You have Wade Hicks, who had just been vetted by Homeland Security, had been vetted by the FBI for enhanced security checks, and was stopped mid-journey to Japan to see his wife in the military and stranded in Hawaii because he couldn't fly anywhere. Never was given any explanation. So this kind of authoritarian bureaucracy that doesn't pay any attention to the law and just rides roughshod over people is accountable to no one and will not tell anybody. To this day, people who are put on the no-fly list are not ever told if they're ever taken off of it. They're never told why they were even put on it. It's like some kind of a star chamber where you're accused in absentia. But at least the star chamber would tell people what they were accused of. We don't even get that from Homeland Security.
And you brought up a good point. You said that they're not accountable to anybody. And we saw that with Napolitano when she was being grilled by, I believe, the congressman. And he said, you know, what's up with this Saudi guy? And she said, well, if I think it's a big deal, I'll get around to telling you
it's
a big deal.
Yeah. Sit down, Congressman. Don't talk to me. And that's kind of the attitude that you're getting about these ammunition purchases as well, right? When they say, you know, why are you getting 1,000 times, why are you using, if you divide it out by the number of people there, why are you using 1,000 times more rounds than the Army's using? You know, well, I can't tell you that. I'm not going to tell you that.
And I think that's a very good point to bring up. I mean, when you're using more rounds domestically than you need in a foreign occupation, I mean, that's a pretty big deal.
Absolutely.
And nobody wants to talk about that. They don't want to talk about the fully automatic AR-15s. They don't want to talk about the armored vehicles. And, you know, everybody, well, not everybody, but you see some of the naysayers saying, well, they bought dump trucks too. And they bought dump trucks. They also have armored vehicles that they say can withstand mines, landmines. They said they need those for warrant sweeps. I know a lot of the Crips and the Bloods like to use landmines in their daily activities and whatnot. That makes absolutely no sense. But I want to get to this, David. We have a link on Drudge. Maybe you guys can pull it up. Update: falsely identified Boston bomber found dead in the river. Now, I believe Alex has been talking about this for some time, saying that, you know, bodies are going to pop up in the river. And sure enough, they did. Mm-hmm. Falsely identified Boston bomber found dead in river. One of the individuals identified as a possible Boston bombing accomplice has been found dead in the Providence River. Police in Providence pulled a man's body from the Providence River on Tuesday, and authorities said it's very possible that it is, forgive me for this pronunciation, Sunli Tripathi, a former Brown University student who has been missing since mid-March. It was pointed out that the image bore a similarity to one of the suspects first named by the FBI. And I remember we had the caller call in the other day, and he said, you know, maybe we should do some crowdsourcing. And I don't think crowdsourcing is necessarily a bad thing, but when you get to the point where you're harassing people, in the very scenario I gave that caller was, you know, they're going to start harassing little girls with backpacks. You know, that the little girl had a black backpack, and it gets way out of hand. But I think it can be a very useful thing, just something to use with extreme caution.
Well, we have an article on InfoWars from Kurt Nemo, and he says the DHS and FBI are warning of terrorists with cameras following the Boston bombing. Now, we just had Peter King, former chair of the House Committee on Homeland Security, saying that, well, you know, we could have stopped this or found these guys quicker if we had more cameras. Well, they had a lot of cameras at the finish line.
And they confiscated cameras from people who were there just filming.
Right. What they don't want, they don't want a free press. They don't want a free citizenry. They don't want people taking pictures of their crime scenes because they want to control what information comes out and what information doesn't. And along that line, we look at this, the implausibility of these two brothers, the second one with the white backpack. Mm-hmm. Now, immediately it was obvious because for days they've been talking about a black backpack. And then when they flagged these guys, they didn't say anything initially about the second guy having a white backpack.
Right.
And so we started talking about it. And then immediately CNN comes on with an explanation, says, well, this is what it would have been.
I think it was less than an hour after that press conference.
Right.
CNN came up with their own probable cause situation for why the backpack was white and not the black backpack. I mean, this was nothing that they got from the FBI that we know of. Mm-hmm. It's just something they came up on their own. Yeah, they just pulled bags out of bags.
They did have an FBI, former FBI profiler, as they introduced him.
an FBI profiler. I want to tell this story. I've told it to David and I told it to the guys in the back. Back when I was in college, I wouldn't say I was recruited by the FBI, but the FBI approached me at a career fair, you know, because I was studying criminal justice, and said, hey, you know, when you get your degrees, you come check out the FBI. And, you know, I just asked him basic question, you know, what about all that FBI profiling I see on the movies? He said, there is no position in the FBI called FBI profiler. None.
And you can verify that at the FBI's website. We went there and looked at FBI, it's the careers section. And if you look at item number 17, because they must get this request a lot, it says, I'd like to be an FBI profiler. And they say, there is no such job as an FBI profiler. But they had an FBI profiler, according to CNN.
Yeah, he is an FBI profiler. Can you guys, if you guys can dig that up, that would be really great, even if we have to wait till the next segment.
So he came on, and he was ready with a demonstration. Now, here's the question, okay? I think that's somewhat implausible, but he's saying that, you know, he had the black backpack in, with a bomb inside it, inside of a white backpack. He would take that out and then leave it down there and then put the white backpack on and go, okay? Well, if he was so clever to do that, why didn't the older brother, who is a mastermind, why didn't he do the same thing? Okay, why didn't he have a white backpack with a black backpack bomb inside of it? I mean, it just, it makes no sense. And we're told that they don't have any video of the older brother setting anything down, but we do have, they say, video of the younger brother setting something down.
Who nobody has seen.
Exactly. They will not show you the video. Now think about this. No person identified by the name in the investigation is saying that they saw the videos, okay? The governor of Massachusetts said that he went to a briefing and they described the video to him. But they didn't show the governor of Massachusetts.
Oh, my gosh. They described it.
Yeah, they described it. So
that's some damning evidence right there. They described a video that nobody has seen.
But that's the whole point of the suspicion about the younger brother, Zohar, is this video where he supposedly took this backpack out of the other one and left it and ran. It's crazy.
Also, guys, again, Alex Jones popping back in here. Guys, great points you're making. Is you have the police chief, you know, the big guy that everybody sees at the press conferences. He said on Fox that he had the whole video of this described to him. First, he said it is just chilling and riveting video. And they said, oh, you've seen it? Well, no. Mm-hmm. I had it described to me. But listen, all that is side issues. I think it's important to list it all as part of the overall continuum of this. But you have to understand, you've got a drill at the exact same time. You've got them desperate to cover up that drill. You've got all these other people with backpacks there, which, again, are part of the drill. We're not saying they're in on it. They're there so that no one can ever find the real guy with the bomb, so the real guy can slip in. How do you, in a country, in a world, where they know there's going to be thousands of cameras, they want the thousands of cameras to create all this fear to usher in a fundamental change in our society towards open martial law? They'll just call it security. They'll call it public safety. How do you have that fundamental shift? Well, you've got to have the footage. But how do you then bomb something and then get your backpack bombs in or whatever they were really in and then have the real perpetrator be able to slip out? You have, it's the old spy trick of have 20 people show up at the same restaurant dressed the same way so that people can't find out who's handing off a package. This is all classic spy stuff out of real spy craft. To have the drill in case you get caught, to say you're part of the drill. And then I say, okay, there's a drill. That just bumped it up to 90% chance. I said this, you know, the day it happened. Okay, a drill's confirmed. People are seeing drills. Okay, the Boston Globe admitted that there was a drill. They had a drill years before there of the same thing happening. Okay, that just bumped it up to 90% because, you know, if you have a drill at the exact same place, exact same time of a bombing, that's what it was for. Unbelievable, you're at 90%. Now, if it comes out they're being shadowed by the FBI and CIA, Kurt Nemo wrote, if they were sent by these foundations that are trying to undermine Russia by sending in Muslim extremists, and we listed the organizations, then it goes to 99%. And folks, it's gone to 99%, and then you get them covering up, trying to kill the brothers, silencing the other brother, dead bodies popping up, the cover-up of this Saudi that somehow is involved. I don't know if it's a patsy or maybe the target. I mean, we don't know, but we know this guy is at the White House. We know Michelle is visiting him, the First Lady. We know this guy is on no-fly list because, again, you've got agencies that aren't actually terrorists that will pick up on these people and put them on a list, or they've done this, they put them on a list so when something gets blown up or if they want to set them up later, they say, oh, look, we were watching them. That's then used as the proof against them as well. And the fact that they're allowed to get on and off planes, Tamerlan is the older brother, with fake names Boom, ladies and gentlemen, we know the workshops he attended with the CIA. We know what he did. We know he went around a mosque to jump up and say, I want to kill infidels, to test and see if there were real radicals in those mosques. But see, when you get hired, because they were secular at first, party guys, you know, wanting to get money, be playboy type guys, you know, they were rock stars. They're out partying. They're not real Muslims. The point is, when you go out and take part in the drills, or when you take part as an infiltrator, posing as a Muslim extremist, you are now creating the history and the ledger to be set up. That's what happened with Tim McVeigh, Lee Harvey Oswald, and everybody else. This is a total intelligence operation. It is a false flag. And when we come back, I'll tell you the motive for it. Then we'll get into the latest on the bullets. The media is in full panic mode trying to cover this up. They are preparing for war against the American people, folks. And if this story gets out, it's over for them. You all know the motives. Set the precedent, as they said. This is like 9/11. You even see the PR rollout. We're now going to be on the streets. You're now all suspects. And what do you say to that, having the Bill of Rights suspended? USA, USA, USA. Cheering tyranny with the chants of USA, USA, USA. So the motive is, let the military-industrial complex eat America fully. This foreign offshore bank-owned monstrosity that is installing Al-Qaeda in Libya and Syria so we can fight the next war with them. See, it's full-spectrum dominance, and it's a way to make us all suspects and then get CISPA passed and just absolutely butcher the Bill of Rights and Constitution and distract from Obama imploding America and shutting down our power plants and shipping our jobs overseas. So it's all meant to make us rally around and see the government as the daddy, as the mommy, as Chris Rock said. You know, Obama's like your dad, so shut up and do what he says. You know, Kim Jong-il, Kim Jong-un, he's like our dad, so shut up and do what he says. You know, Hitler, he's like our dad, shut up and do what he says. I mean, that's what every group that loves authoritarianism says. And you watch that video up at Infowars.com, that has to go viral everywhere. Californians signed petition to bring in Nazi rule. And they would say, yeah, please sign the petition to confiscate the guns and bring in Nazi fascism in America. And these are people that spoke English, black, Hispanic, you name it, white. Mainly whites and Hispanics, and that's the people. That's everyone that we asked. It's not like we're cherry-picking here. They were out there 15 minutes. It's like a seven-minute video because they just, you know, cut out the parts while they were waiting for somebody to walk up on the boardwalk. Everyone we talked to, except for one group of people, so that's like 90% said, we want to take the guns and live under Nazi rule because they don't know even what Nazis are. It's like, it's for the earth, the children, the Nazis will run everything and take the guns. Oh, I'm for that. Thank you. Thank you for supporting the Nazis, ma'am. And it's we're going to get more and more extreme, more and more insane with the stuff we're going to call for, and people are going to sign for it. Now, shifting gears, we're going to cover this more after Ron Paul leaves. This is a big deal. The listeners of this broadcast, Infowars.com, PrisonPlanet.com, and give credit where credit's due, DrudgeReport.com. Rammed this story, just like the TSA and so many other issues, into light. When we first started reporting on it a year ago, it was only a billion bullets. Since then, it's about a year and a half period now, it's over 2,200,000,000 bullets. And it's training with paper targets of children. It's that's people couldn't even believe that. It's on record. This is all designed for us. This whole program, and the fact that they, in every news article bashing us and saying InfoWars is lying, Drudge is lying, these crazy congressmen have picked up what Drudge and Jones are doing. And I mean, she got asked about it last week. She got asked again today. Hey, what about the 2 billion bullets? She goes, well, Drudge is not a credible source. And he's like, but Drudge linked to Forbes. I mean, isn't that credible? Of course, it's all credible because it's the government's purchase orders, their own website. And then they say in all the articles, oh, the debunked Drudge story. Yeah, these people are nuts. Yeah, we bought 2 billion bullets. It's no big deal. It's like we're debunked because we broke it, pushed it. And they're like, man, look at these crazy people. You know, they said there was a rodeo going on in this town and we showed up and there was a rodeo. They're debunked. Or look at this crazy guy. You know, he says he's in Dallas, Texas, and there he is in Dallas, Texas. This is nuts. This guy is, you know, this guy, 2 + 2 = 4. He's crazy because he's right. I mean, it is just, it's debunked because we got the bullets and they're for you. Visit Infowars.com and PrisonPlanet.com. When you're on the site, you can also tune in 24 hours a day to my daily radio broadcast. There's also a free iPhone app to listen to the syndicated radio show when and where you want.